The topic which has been given to me today is that how you can improve your effectiveness, how you can improve your efficiency. And I think that you can only improve your efficiency if you know yourself quite well. There are various authors who have given various theorems, and I'm going to make this half an hour session full of video clippings, and I would like to rather answer questions rather than to talk technical things, because I've been given to understand that the session is going to the industry also. So my first question to you is, how you can be successful in your life? What does success means to you? Anyone in the audience? What does success means to you?
Giving happiness to each and everyone who we are surrounded by, specifically our parents, our mentors and faculty.
Okay, very good. That you want to give happiness to your parents, and that gives you, and that's a definition of success. Anyone else? Okay. So what's the goal of your, what, okay, fine. Let me come on the goals. So let me come on the goals first. So what's the goal of your life?
Be a successful person.
To be a successful person. Anyone else?
Self-contentment.
Okay. Contentment.
Any success obviously gives a lot of happiness. But what happiness that I will get, that my success is towards a particular cause which benefits the society, which benefits the country. That probably success will mean much more to me. That yes, I will be successful in contributing something to the society.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay, but what is your goal?
Sir, what happens when I am out of success, but we can't able to achieve that? So we need to have a balance control in our life so we can achieve that. For that matter, we need to have a right action plan to achieve our respective goals in our life.
Okay. What's your age? About 34?
32. Sir.
32. Yeah. 32 year of age, and when we are asking him a spontaneous question that what is the goal of your life, he's starting thinking, and today he is saying that I'm not very clear what's the goal of my life. And that's the same story with almost everyone. I think that if this question you ask to a person who is about to die at the age of 75, 78, 80, and you ask him that what is our goal of your life, why you live for 80 years, I think that he has to think about it, that why he actually lived. Right? Why you are living? Why you are living?
For
your parents. That's it.
Yes.
Okay. Anyone else? Why you are living?
To achieve something in
your life. To achieve, but what is that something?
That you are not clear.
That you are not clear. So I think that we should start from here. That first of all, to increase your efficiency. Efficiency for what? Efficiency for what? Maybe that a person is able to earn a lot of money, but that money, is it going to give him satisfaction? Right? That's a question mark. And today we are going to talk about it, that if you have a goal, then do you think that that is really a goal of your life? I have often come across people that when you talk artificially with them, like for example, you give them a chance to think about something, and then you say that, well, now you talk on this topic. They can be highly artificial. They can talk for hours on that topic. They can mesmerize you. But when you don't give them a chance, and then suddenly you ask them a question, what's the goal of your life? What's the goal of your life? They are not able to answer that what's the goal of their life. Right? And when the goal of your life is not defined, you are not able to perform. The goal of a mother is to bring up a child. And you can see that there is excitement in it. Right? The goal is very clear, it's very focused, that the life of a mother is in a child. It's very clear. And once it's very clear, there is a passion. Many times, the people, they ask me that how you can generate passion. How you can generate passion. Right? That in my life, maza nahi aa raha. I am not getting enjoyment in my life. So how should I enjoy my life? So this is another question which normally people ask. And when you don't get enjoyment, your efficiency comes down. So the question is the fear, right? That why you fear? What fear? Right? And when you have a fear in your mind, you are not able to perform. When you have a fear of something, then you are not able to give your 100%. When you have a fear of stage, you can't speak. When you have a fear of a boss, you can't perform. When you are in a fear, your efficiency level comes down. So for the first of all, we need to be very clear that what's the goal of our life, and whatever we want to do in our life, how we are going to achieve it. Someone was talking about an action plan, and I'm going to talk about a story. And this story goes to a person who made his goal very, very clear. And let's go to the history. And if you look at the history, the people who have been at the helm of the affairs, or those who have created the history of the various companies in the world, you will find that they were the ones who defined their goals very, very early. In their life, they were so focused, they were so clear right from the very beginning of their life what they want to do. For example, the mother is very clear that she has to bring up a child. So even if she is having 102 fever, she will get up in the morning, she has to cook, she has to make a tiffin for a child, and she has to make it sure that the child goes to school. Similarly, you must have seen that the founders of the various organizations, or the leaders of the various companies or various countries, they have a passion, and they have a passion to perform. Whatever may come in their life, if they have taken a job, they will do it. Right? If they have a team, it's fine. If they don't have a team, they create it. Now the question is that how to come to that level, how you should renew your energy, right? How you can infuse that kind of energy, and can you give a vision to a person? Can vision be taught? It's a question mark. And let me give you a story. I'm going to take one case. One of a person who at a very young age has been the president of MDRT. I'm also going to take two cases where a person who was deprived of everything but still reached at the top. And let me try to see that how the message reaches to you. The story goes of a person, his name is Stephen Rothschild, and he has been the president of MDRT. MDRT is a platform where they call the people who have done something in their life very significantly. Those who are the finance professionals, those who are the insurance professionals, they call them every year at MDRT. And I met this gentleman, his name is Stephen Rothschild, and he gave his story. In MDRT, normally 10,000 people come on the opening day, and the person who comes on the main platform is a gentleman who has done something very substantial in his life. When Stephen came on the stage, and this was long, I think about 8-9 years back at New Orleans, when Stephen came on the stage, people were sitting very patiently to listen to this gentleman who has been their role model, who is a financial icon in the United States of America. And Stephen came and started speaking. And what he spoke, I'm going to give you a story. He said that today, I know that all of you want to listen to a successful man. A man who has been very famous. A man who has got private planes. A man who is the owner of about 78 companies. More than 50,000 people, they report to me. And all of you want to know that what is my success mantra, how I have been very successful. But I'm not going to give you a story of a successful man. I'm going to give you a story of an unsuccessful child. And he started speaking about himself. And he said that today I am a financial professional, an icon in the industry. But if someone asks me that what was the name of my father, I will not be able to give you the name of my father. I don't know who he was, whether he was a Jew, whether he was a Muslim, whether he was from Latin America, whether he was from Asia, I don't know. But I remember my mom, my mother, who used to love me unconditionally. But I also remember that my mother used to cry, sometime in a kitchen, sometime in a living room. And I used to ask my mom, Mom, why you cry? And she used to hug me and used to tell me, Stephens, I live for one goal. One goal. I want to see you very successful in life. Will you become successful? And I always used to tell my mom, Mom, I will surely become successful. This is my promise to you that one fine day I will have a huge house in Manhattan. I will take you on a private plane on a work trip. Right? I will put you on a 7-star hotel. Mom, let me tell you, there is no luxury which you will not get in your life. And my mom used to hug me and used to say, oh my Stephens, oh my CEO, I salute you. God was never kind to me, because I was just 6 years old. One day when I was coming back from my school, I saw that there was a huge crowd in front of my small flat which we had in New York. There was a fire, there was an ambulance, there was a police standing in front of my house. I asked someone, what has happened? And my neighbor told me, poor Stephens, your mother is no more. He has committed suicide. At the age of 6, I hardly knew the meaning of the word suicide. But I knew that my mother is no more. And for the last time, when I hugged the body of my mom and I kissed her for the last time, her eyes were still open. It seemed to me as if she was asking me the same question, Stephens, will you become successful? And let me tell you this great story of United States of America, where I'm a financial icon, where my assets are over 20 billion. No one even offered me a piece of bread. Someone, my uncle, from Memphis, he came 3 days later, and he took me to a place called Memphis, from where I started my career. And my story of exploitation started from Memphis. My cousins used to go in the private schools, which are very expensive in the United States. And I was made to study in a government-funded state school. No breakfast in the morning. No breakfast. No one ever packed lunch for me. My job was to do dishes of the entire house. I used to wash utensils, do dusting. Right, late in the evening, sometimes dinner, sometimes I will not get dinner also. And this happened for about a month. And when no one motivated me, I had to motivate myself. So I went to my uncle and said, Papa, I need to speak to you. And I thought that if I'll address this gentleman with the word Papa, maybe that I will get that something in my life which I was missing. And that's what my message to you is, that sometimes you don't get what you are asking for in your life. Many times you ask so many things that this will happen, but that never happens. So what you should do, should you die, right? Should you cry, should you perform? And this was the commitment of 6 year old, that how he addressed. He said, Papa, I need to speak to you. And this gentleman started abusing, shouting, and thrashing him. He said, I'm not your father. You know the story of your mom, what kind of female she was. That night, I had to open a dictionary to understand that what my mom was. I was looking at the wounds, which physically I got from this person, but much more than the physical pain, I was having a spiritual pain. That night, I prayed to the God, not to live, but to die. I said, oh God, oh Jesus, my mother used to pray to you daily. Is this what you are giving to us? Please return my mom, please return my mom, please return my mom to me. I am alone, I am thirsty, I am hungry. Look, that someone has beaten me. My body is swollen all over. Will you please return my mom? I want to hug my mother. I want that she should be with me. God was very cruel. Very cruel. He never returned my mother to me. That night, I learned that those who go, they never came back. I kept on praying. I kept on saying, Mom, please come back. Please come back. I will never ask for a teddy bear. I will do my homework. I will do my assignments. God, please send my mother back. 6 year old, no answer. Next day, when I went to the school, my eyes were swollen like this. And when everyone else was playing baseball and basketball, I wrote in my copy a vision statement, and I didn't knew what my goal and my what vision was. But out of that pain which I suffered, the circumstances I had, out of that pain, I wrote one line. One day, I am going to own this entire city of Memphis. And Stephen owned it. He started Federal Express from there, and later owned almost the entire city, made a governor, became the governor of the city. And same is the story of Clinton. He writes in his book, My Life, that when Clinton was very young, as a child, he used to sleep in his car. And he has a similar story, similar kind of pain. And he writes in his autobiography, in his book, My Life, that I had so much pain because when I was young, no one told me that who my father was. I never get that affection in my life. And when my maternal grandfather used to go for a job, who was a watchman, I used to pray to the God daily and used to say that, oh God, give me that power, give me that vision, give me those things and make me so powerful that one day when I grow up, I am able to ensure that everyone in the United States of America has a house and no child has to sleep in a car. Now this was a passion. On the back of the mind in psychology, we say that on the back of the mind you have a thought. And when that thought becomes your passion, becomes your goal, you have to be successful. No one can stop you. So if you have to become successful in your life, you need to see. And if you want to increase your efficiency, what is that one thing which is at the back of your life? Right? Is it sports? Right? Is it singing? Right? Is it research? Right? Is it starting a business? Right? Or is it something else? And once you discover it, and when your job becomes your passion, and when the job becomes so focused, you have to be successful. No one can stop you. And there are so many stories, right, which you will get from the history. That person was here, was nowhere else in life. And suddenly he thought and he discovered himself that this is what is exciting me. Right? So either something should excite you or you should create excitement. Because if there is no excitement, it's a routine work, it's a routine job, it's death. It's death. Right? If a child comes here in this hall and he comes, there will be a natural expression. And the natural expression is of affection. If a child comes here, right, the natural affection is that he'll come to you and he is going to speak to you and you are going to say, ha ha, how are you? How are you? Right? So that's a natural affection which comes out. It doesn't come when I see my colleagues. Right? We often see that people, they come each other, they don't say good morning. They don't say hi. Right? They are so confused because they have their preconceived ideas. If he will go high, he is going to harm me. That's your problem. That's your problem, actually. Because you are thinking that if he will go high, then he is going to harm you. And because you have that perception that he is going to harm you, that there is a paraphilia around you. Right? That this man is going to harm me. And because you have that conception that he is going to harm you, you start deciding or you start talking that how you have to bring him down. If he's coming up with some innovation, bring him down. If he's coming up with an idea, say, no, this is not an idea. Bring him down. And in that course, what you do is that 70% of your energy goes in putting a person down. And when you start putting a person down, you're not focused. You don't have a goal to achieve. Your only goal is then to compete against another person. Successful people, they make their own benchmarks. They don't copy others. They are the founders. They will create something new. They will create something which is original. They will not copy. They will come up with something which is very, very original, which is their passion, which is their heart. Right? And when something comes by heart, naturally your efficiency will increase. Normally the question which we face is that how is it so that the problems occur in an organization? Why is it so that there is a conflict in life? Why is it so that people fight with each other? Right? And there is a model which we have produced in our business school, and we are going to show it to you. There are three kind of personalities in the world, and three scenarios in which you work. We call them dominant, passive. First kind of personality and the first kind of scenario is that where a person is passive and the other person is also passive. So you are two passive people, they are working together. So boss is also passive, subordinate is also passive. Father is also passive, son is also passive. Wife is also passive, husband is also passive. Parent is also very passive, right? And the child in the family is also passive. There will be no problem. There will be no growth, but there is no problem at all. Employer is passive, employee is passive. Boss is passive, and the subordinate is also passive. So boss comes up, and boss says, today I don't feel like working. And the subordinate says, sir, I also feel so. Right? So boss is very relaxed. He will always come late. He will go early. And he says, well, today I don't feel like working. Let's go to the office of this person and let's have a cup of tea. And the subordinate says, sir, should I also accompany you? So both of them, they will never have a problem. Passive versus passive. They will not work. They will do good sycophancy. Right? No one will ever trouble them. They are non-existent entities in an organization. In a family, they will always have a very peaceful life, no growth, nothing. Right? Second kind of scenario is where the boss is very dominant. Very, very dominant. Right? And the subordinate is very passive. Now, here also the chances are that you will never have a problem. Because the boss is so dominant that daily in the morning, before he enters into his room, right, he will give 20 things to his people. He will come restless that today I have to do 30 things in a day. So before he starts dictating. You have to do this, you have to do that, you have to do action plan, I want reports on this, right? So a passive person, you know, he will keep on doing it. So there is no problem. You remember the days, you know, we did some research that why is it so that divorce rate in America is very high, Japan is very high, in villages in India it's very low, somehow in the metro it's very high. We did some research, actual research, and very amazing results came up. Right? If a person is very dominant and his wife is very passive, there will never be a problem. Right? Look at the old days. Right? There was a man, let's say farmer, and I can talk about myself. Right? Let's say that there is a person from the fields, from the North India, and he comes up, comes from the field. Right? He is very strong. Since morning, he's working in the field. 4:30, he gets up, goes in the field, works. And in the evening, he comes back. 24-year-old, strong man. Right? And then when the strong man comes, and he says, Santo! And Santo is a beautiful girl. Beautiful. 19-year-old girl, fair complexion, pink suit, long hair. And she says, I'm coming, IG. Right? And this man says, IG, come fast. And she says, yes, I'm coming. Actually, I was preparing lassi for you. Lassi is a cold drink in Punjab. I was making lassi for you. Now he's very happy that, look, she is very good. She is giving me lassi. And she says, and he takes a lassi from her. Okay, give me. And he takes one sip. Now he is a bit composed. And he says, better, sit down. Right? She says, no, I am very comfortable here only. No, please sit down. Right? He says, no, I'm very comfortable here. He says, no, please sit down. Have a sip. You also take lassi. You also take cold drink. And she says, no, I think that if you have taken, then I have taken. Right? Aapne le liya, maine le liya. Right? If you have taken, I have taken. And this man gets very happy. He says, I'm very happy. Oh, khush kar deta. In Punjabi, they say, khush kar deta. Oh, I'm very happy now. Right? And she says, she's also very happy. Now he says, tu kuch mang. You ask for something. Because he's happy from inside. internal satisfaction he has got. So he says, "Tu kuch mang, you please ask for something." And she says, no, I have got you, I have got God. Aap mil gaye, khuda mil gaya. So kehta, oh, santo, now you have to ask something. Now you need to ask for something. And she says, okay, if you are saying so much, then give me a nolakahar. Give me a jewelry, nolakahar dila do. Now this man, right, he will surely bring a nolakahar for her. Right? Unconditionally, she is supporting her boss, her husband. Right? Now, this can be any relationship. Right? When there is an unconditional support, I'm not saying this is right, but sometimes it happens, passive versus passive. The boss says that I will not work, subordinate also says I will not work. Whatever you may do, in the first case, you can't make people work because both of them, they are in their comfort zone. And they have made their comfort zone. In the morning, the boss says and comes up and says, you need to do this. Super boss comes, you need to do this. The passive person says, yes, sir, I will do it, sir. Sir, I will do it, sir. And he says that, how will you do it? Right? Sir, jaan laga denge, sir. Right? We will give life on this project, sir. Right? And the boss is very happy initially few months or initial days. Okay, if you can give your life, please do this project. Okay, sir. Right, sir, jaan laga denge, sir. Right, and then, you know, that he gives them a deadline, 10 days. 9.5 days is not working, and the boss calls up, sir, we are working on the project, sir. Sir, it's happening, sir. We will do it, sir. Right, and finally, the boss says that, well, I think that today is a deadline. We have to submit this report, right, and you need to do it. And he says, sir, we are doing it, sir. Sir, jaan laga di, sir. Sir, we are doing it, sir. Right. And the boss says, okay, fine, you are giving your life, but the project is not complete. 15 minutes later, we have to submit it. Right. And he says, sir, actually, we tried it, sir. Sir, please extend, give some more time, sir. Sir, give us, today is Friday, sir. By Monday, it will be on our table, sir. Right. So boss says, okay, fine, let me give you 3 more days. Please do it. So 3 more days, again, both of them, they will come out of the room and will laugh. Right? The boss is saying so many things, right? And he doesn't know that we have never worked, we will never work. Right? So they come back. And next Monday happens. So the boss again calls up and says that, well, you told me that this you will be able to do it, sir. Do it. Have you done it? Right? He says, that sir, jaan laga diye, sir. But sir, we are not able to do it, sir. Sir, we'll do it. Sir, we'll do it. But sir, can you please give us some guidance, sir? With your guidance, we will be able to draft this report. And the boss starts thinking that if I have to dictate this entire concept to you, then why I should give this job to you? So he calls then a performer, a dominant person, which is a third class. Now the problem comes up. First case, no problems at all. Passive versus passive, non-existent. These people, they will be in an organization for quite long. No one will ever ask a question to them. And even if they ask a question, they know that this will never happen. So dynamic things will not be given to them. Vibrant things will not be given to them. They keep on existing in an organization and one day they retire. Second case, the boss is very dominant. The subordinate is a bit passive. They will also live. Right, but organization maybe has some peace, family has a peace, right, or a country has a peace. The third problem comes up. The problem actually comes up with the people like you who are highly educated, because now the santo comes santi, and she is highly educated, right, and Mahinder becomes Mahi, and he is also highly educated. Right now, the Mahi, who is a CEO of a company, he comes at 10:30, and his wife is also a well-placed professional. Right, and both of them, they are in an apartment, 100th floor. Right, lavish lifestyle, good car, good house, everything is good. Right, and now he comes up at 10 late in the evening, and bells up. Right, ting ting. Right, and the wife comes up. And he says, I am very tired today, darling. I'm very tired. And the wife says, so do I. I'm also very tired. Oh, right. He says, what oh ho? What oh ho? Right, and he says, not again. Please don't start it. Right. I, throughout the day, I was in meetings, I was giving presentation. Can I have a cup of coffee? Can you make a coffee for me? And he says that, well, I also came at 7:30, and then I was sitting with your son, and we were doing homework together, we did assignments. I'm also very tired. Right? There's a food in kitchen, if you want, you can eat. Right? Go and do microwave, eat. Now this man, you know, he starts eating, he goes in a kitchen and doesn't feel like. And he says that, what is my life? I am earning so much. Right? I work very hard. I have brought good cars. I have brought good house. And look, this is the kind of treatment I'm getting. Right? And then he says, well, let me tell you, because he's not able, because he's throughout the day. Let me tell you, Santi, since I am married, right, I had a desire that whenever I come back, then you should always welcome me. Right? And she says, well, I also had a desire that you should come at right time, and whenever you come, you should help me in a kitchen and while writing the assignments of your son. And he says, you have again started. Phir kahan shuru ho gayi. Right? And then she says, kahan shuru ho gayi to chhod do na. Because two dominant persons, they are saying. And he says, well, I think that let's decide today. Well, let's decide today, right? If it is a problem, right, then let's leave each other. Right? I think that you can leave in the morning. And then she says, hey, listen. I have 40% share in the investment. So it's better that you leave. So now the discussion is on investments. It's not that both of them, they don't like each other. They like each other. Right? And both of them, they have to live together for a common goal. For what purpose they are earning? They're earning for their only son. Right? Both of them, they are well placed. They have got good car, they have got good house. But somewhere the goal is missing. What they actually wanted to achieve. And this happens in an organization also. Two dominant people, when they have to come together and they have to work together, the biggest problem is understanding the goal and the priorities of each other. When you are not able to understand the priority of each other, normally there is a conflict and your efficiency level comes down. Because daily if you will fight at home, and then you come to your office, whole night you are fighting with each other. And when you come on your desk, it is going to affect your efficiency. You don't know. You are lost somewhere. So when you are lost somewhere, how will you perform? And same is in an organization. When you are fighting and daily 40% of your time is going on counter attacks to each other, then how will you perform? You take an initiative, someone will bring you down. So I think the problem in the world, in the organization behavior, and I think in your personal lives is that if you really want to be very focused, the question is that how you should keep your goal very high and how you should resolve this conflict, which is very, very, very important. The third question which many people they do ask is that to be successful, how you should have your broad vision. The vision has to be great. Now, if you want to be successful in life, you need to sometime sit and think that how should I think? You should sit sometime and also think that how should you think? Thinking is an art. Many times you don't have to speak. You just have to listen. And your body gesture shows that how much you are interested in the speech of the other person or not. I have always seen that foolish, they speak quite a lot. Right? Sitting in a meeting is an art. Right? Writing a letter, writing an email is an art. Convening a meeting is an art. Attitude is an art. How you sit in a meeting is an art. How you do follow-up is an art. Right? Everyone knows that this is to be done, but there are very few who are able to do what is to be done. So why is it so that there are few who are able to achieve something which is very great, and there are few who are not able to do it. I think it's focus. Focus and defining what you want to achieve at. Right? If you are in the company of, and somewhere, you know, when I was very young, my mother told me that a man is known by the company you keep. Right? And I think that the more I learn and the more I speak to people, it's very clear. Right? If there are two smokers who are sitting in this room, you can see that they're sitting together. I know it. You don't have to actually. You can always see two smokers, right? They will always find each other. Isn't it?
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. They will always find each other. You don't have to tell that I smoke or I don't. Two scholars, they will find each other. Right? Those who have to go for a late night movie, they will find each other. You don't have to define, you don't have to tell them. A person will reach Heathrow. Hunt for casino if he has to go to casino. Right, the other one, if he has to go to a temple or to a gurdwara, he will look at, okay, fine, there's a south hall and maybe that I need to go there and I have to offer prayers in a temple or in a gurdwara or in a church or in a mosque. So it's very clear that what do you think you will be. Right? We have kept in the business school virtual rupees. So you can come and you can see that how how 1 crore rupees or $1 million or £1 million look like. Because if you'll keep on looking at them, in the business school we have kept a big screen on the stocks and the prices, right, of the various currencies they keep on coming. And many times people ask you why they are in front of your room. Because we want our students to learn it. The more they will see, they will have a passion. And if they will see, one day they will play on it. But it's very, very clear that a strong man will always like to have strong people around him. A strong leader will always like to have strong subordinates. A strong team will always like to have like-minded people. A weak boss will always like to have weak people around him. So always look at that. What is your goal? If your goal is very high, then don't compromise on the people who are at this level. Your goal is here. So your goal is here. You need to work with the competent people. You have to work with the dominant ones. And the art is that how you retain those dominant ones. Because if you'll keep on firing the dominant ones, a person is good. He is excellent. And you fire him. You have lost him. If there's an excellent researcher, and you feel that he is going to create a problem for you, he's going to challenge your research, and you fire him, you have lost him. So you need to hire a person who is maybe better than you, and then you have to retain him. And the art of leadership is that be with him, take him along, and build a great team. And that is what the leadership is. So for your goal, which is here, you don't require people who are yes men, who always says yes sir. You require people who have a courage to stand and say, well, this is right and this is wrong. Similarly, in a house or in any organization, in any religion, in any country, if a country has to grow, there has to be a person who can come up and say that, well, we want these things. There's a change, right? There's a theorem which says obsolete yourself. If you will not, then someone else will. You have to obsolete yourself, upgrade yourself, do research, right? Understand that what is happening. If you will not, then someone else will surely come at your place. So this is another theorem which you need to look into your mind. It should be in your brain that whenever you visualize something very big. I'm going to take now very quickly 10 lessons of life which has been given by a great practitioner. This studio where we are sitting is a studio of MIT. Right? And I can say this with authority, because I am with MIT from the day one. And there is a person called Dr. Ashok Chauhan. Right? Many of you know him. And those who don't know him, I think whenever you get a chance to speak to him, right, please speak to him. And very recently, just 2 weeks back, he was in a new campus in Gwalior where, you know, he gave the vision of his life. A man who at this age, a billionaire, who has earned so much, right, who has done something for the society. He gave his own formula that how he became successful and how you can become successful. And I thought that let me share his theorem with you, which can be the one of the best theorems which you may have come across in the organization behavior or in the HR. So he came on the stage and he gave his first line. Right, without any paper, he started speaking. And he said that if you really want to become very big, you need to dream very big. Not everyone can dream big. Not everyone can dream big. Right? When he came from Germany, and I remember when I met him, he talked not about opening a small thing. He said, one day we will have many universities, and you don't have anything. And he tells us that when he was in Germany, he used to tell the people with whom he used to interact, one day I will become a billionaire. So you have a vision, you have a goal, ultimate goal of your life that I have to reach here. If you are thinking that you will be very satisfied working for a company where the salary will be 20,000, the person will get 20,000. But if you have got a vision to reach here, then you will surely reach here. And I'm going to show you a clipping and give you a story which is based on this first learning of a Mary Lou. It's a real life story of a girl who won Olympic gold. Right? And she was handicapped. As you know, that there are few children, there are few people who have got flat feet. Right? Those who have got flat feet, they can't run very fast. Normally they are not taken in defense forces. They are not athletes. They are not good gymnasts. And Mary Lou had a similar problem. Right? She was the one who was having flat feet. But she had a passion about which we spoke, a goal which we spoke. She wanted to learn gymnastics. Right? So she went to her father and said, Papa, I need to learn gymnastics. Father was a rich man. He said, well, if you want to learn gymnastics, we will take you to the best institution. Best institution of the world I'm going to take you. Right? But so he took him to the best coach of United States of America. It's a real life story. The coach met this girl and said, well, I may take this student, but before I take this student, I need to interview the parents. The father said, okay, fine. If you want to interview us. Tell me, what is your fee? I'll write a check. If you want new building to be made, I will make a new building for you. Right? If you want some apparatus to be given to the gymnasium, I can give you apparatus. Tell me, what is to be done? We will pay you. He said, no, I don't need it. Government is paying me. They're paying me quite well. But I normally take not more than 5 students in a year. So I have to ask you some questions. And my question is very focused. Do you want your daughter to learn gymnastics, or do you want your daughter to win Olympic gold? There's a difference between it. Are you working? Right? Are you working for a job? Right? Are you working for a passion? Are you here in a university to just do a program, or you are here to make a career? The difference. Are you here to learn gymnastics, or you are here to win Olympic gold? Father said, sir, you are joking. You know the problem of my daughter. She has a flat feet. We just want that she should learn some basics of gymnastics, and that is it. The coach said, thank you so much, sir. You are a great man, but I will not be able to teach gymnastics to your daughter. Right? And he said, why? How can you discriminate? You can't discriminate between the two students. Right? We are here. We are paying you fee. We have come. We are applying. You tell us that why you're rejecting. He says that, well, I'm rejecting you. If you want, you can sue me. Right? And the father said, I'm going to take you to court because you're discriminating. He said, please take me to court. Right? But I am not going to teach your daughter. While the father was coming out, and the mother was coming out, Mary Lou started crying. And he saw the coach and said, sir, just 1 minute. And the coach came closer. He said, what? Why are you crying? He said that, sir, you are asking for 1 Olympic gold. I will give you 3 Olympic gold. 3 Olympic gold. 6-year-old girl, right, was committing. the coach saw something unique in her eyes, commitment level, and he said, I'm going to coach you. And he told the parents, but only on the condition next 6 years, you will not enter into my institution. Right? You will not disturb me. Right? She is not going to come home. And you are not going to disturb her daily. If you want, you can meet her. But she's not going to come home. Right? Are you ready for it? The parents discussed and they left their daughter there because she had a passion only towards gymnastics. 5 years later, this girl was picked up in the national team of United States of America. And this is a real life story. I'm going to show you Olympics. 5.5 years later, she was performing in Olympics. In Olympics, on the final day, maybe the TV will show you the photograph, her competition was against the Romanian gymnast, who got a score at that time, quite old tripping, 9.99, 9.99, 9.99. And those were the days that no one would have ever got a perfect 10. And later on, she wrote an autobiography, Perfect 10, that how you can get a perfect 10, 10 out of 10. And Mary Lou went to her teacher and said, sir, today is a great day. Right? Teacher said, come on. Right? He said, I want to thank you, sir, for whatever you did for me. Coach said, for what? For what you are thanking me? She said, sir, I am going to win first medal of my life. And coach got irritated. He said, what you sent? You get first medal? Or you will get gold medal. She said, sir, I don't know, because the other one has got 9.99. My score is much less, right? So I don't know, but maybe a silver medal. I hope that I will make you proud. And coach scolded her, and it's all recorded. The coach scolded her. He said, well, Mary Lou, I have not wasted my 6 years of life that on the final day when you are competing, you are saying that you are going to give me silver medal. You committed 3 gold medals. I am telling you, you will get 11 out of 10. He said, but sir, how? How can one get 11 out of 10? He says, because your teacher is telling you. Your coach is telling you that you will get 11 out of 10. You will get 11 out of 10. Go and perform. And I am telling you, you will get a gold medal. Remember what Shri Krishna told to Arjun, that when you are in a battlefield, when you are doing karma, then forget what you are doing. Right? Forget it who is in front of you. When you are on a job, you are on a job. Even if you have to work whole night, you have to work whole night. Right? Finish your job and then sleep. If you want to be a topper, you want to get 100% marks, you want to achieve something, you have to be convinced about it that you are going to do it. This is your goal. If yourself you are saying that, well, this goal I will be able, not maybe, maybe not, maybe, maybe not, maybe that I will do it. No. Have a very high aim, very, very high aim, and then try to achieve it. You need to achieve it. Right? It has to be your passion. Right? If you have to start something, maybe for 10 nights you need to work. You need to work in your office. You need to, maybe that you will not sleep. You have to sleep in your office, on your table. It has to be flowing in your veins. And if it will flow in your veins, you will be successful. So he told Mary Lou, you don't have to look at what and who is in front of you. You just need to remember that you promised me that you are going to give me gold. Concentrate only on your benchmark. No one is your benchmark. Who is in front of you, it doesn't matter. What he has got doesn't matter. Which car he's driving doesn't matter. What matters is that you need to perform. And Mary Lou started running and she created history. Please watch this clipping. This is a photograph of the coach. And this is Los Angeles Olympics game. The individual all-around competition turned into a duel between Mary Lou Retton of the United States and Ikaru. And this is Mary Lou. And that's Romanian gymnast. The point separated the two as Retton prepared for her final apparatus, the vault. Zabel had already completed her competition And this is how she won the first Olympic gold and first woman who got 10 out of 10 in gymnastic and curricular history. So this is very clear that if the goal is very clear in your life, whatever you are thinking is very clear and you don't have a fear and you can experiment, there are no negative thoughts in your mind and you are committed, you are going to achieve it. The second point which Dr. Chauhan spoke was that normally people don't define and they lose their yes and curiosity. Right? They don't define. You keep a vision very high that, well, I should have this car. Well, that can be one goal, that you should have one car. I don't know whether it's a good goal or it's a bad goal. But you have kept a goal, but then you don't work for it. You don't work for it. If you don't work for it, you'll never get it. So people normally, they keep a goal, but they don't work for it. They don't define it. So if you are keeping a goal, define it, that how you are going to achieve it. How you're going to achieve it. And thirdly, normally a person loses his curiosity, loses his interest. You keep a very high goal, you're going to do it. Right? And normally when someone motivates, you are ready. At that very moment, you are very ready. For example, gentlemen, come here. If you, please come here. Come here. Quickly, come here. Right. I think that you can do it. Right. If I give you a weight, and if I tell you that you have to do a curling of 120 kg, will you try? Will you do it? Will you do it? Yes, I'll do it. How will you do it? You have never done 30 kg curling. Please sit down. Right. You can't do it. You just can't do it. Right? Motivation doesn't mean that we should be foolish. Right? We should be foolish. Right? But he can do it because I know that he goes step by step. So you need to define that if you have to do 120 kg curling, then how you are going to do it? If you can do 30 today, then you need to resist. You are doing 7 repetitions, then you have to do 9 repetitions now of 35. Then you have to do 45. Right, and then there will be a pain. Remember, whenever your size grows in life, there will be a pain. Whenever your size grows, whenever your role changes, there will be a pain. Without pain, you can't conceive. It's a golden formula. And many times, my students and many of the companies where I go, they say that, well, we are having problems, we are having tension, we have stress. Stress should not stress you. You should stress the stress. Stress should not stress you. You should stress the stress, because if your role is changing, there will be a pain, right? When you are a child, right, you are different. When you come in your teenage, you are different. Your role changes, and when your role changes, there are changes. Sometimes people are not able to adjust, and if you're not able to adjust, there are problems. Then from a teenage, you come to a college. First day in a hostel is very tough. It's very, very tough, right? You have never done ironing. You have never done many things, right? So first day is very tough. In NDA, your first few days are very tough, and Colonel Durgan is smiling. First few days are very tough, and many people, they come back. They just come back. They say, no, we don't want to. We don't want to be in army, isn't it? Absolutely. Right? Many people, they just come back. Right? They say, no, we will not play football. We will not play soccer. 4 in the morning, you are telling us to stand up. Then you are telling us not to eat burgers. You are telling us not to eat pizza. Young age, you need to be disciplined. Right? But these small steps make you perfect. And I have seen people from a small flat, right, going and occupying huge companies. How is it so that a person who is very small, lives in a small flat, is able to create something great? And there are few that who are not able to do anything in their life. Anything in their life. I think the line is very thin. It's a discipline of your life. How you do it? If you lose your curiosity, right? If you are having pain and you say that, well, I am having pain, I will not be able to do it. You will be able to 30 to 45 and then lose it. And 6 months later, you will not be able to even lift 30. So you need to upgrade yourself daily. If you lose your curiosity, you want to shed weight, you start jogging from 30 minutes, from 5 minutes to 20 minutes, to 30 minutes, to 1 hour, maybe that you can run marathon. But you can't run marathon on the very first day. So you need to gradually go. But normally, 95% people, they lose their curiosity. And once you lose your curiosity and passion, you are not able to achieve here. You always have to prepare yourself that, well, I need to do 125 kg, but I need to train myself. Right? So this was the third lesson which he gave. And the fourth lesson which he gave was that strive for excellence. There are very few people who will like to go for only for excellence. It's very easy to be mediocre. It is so easy to be mediocre. Right? You take up a subject which is very easy, do it. Right? You will be selected in a mediocre company, work there. Right? Go to the middle level where someone tells you this needs to be done. You say, okay, we will do it. Take a normal salary, come back. The problem comes up that where you want to take up the toughest program, toughest course. You want to do two specializations. You need to work very hard. You need to work for 18, 19 hours a day. A day. 18, 19 hours a day consistently. You need to perform. Right? And whatever you are doing in the excellent way. When others are copying, you are writing original things. Very difficult. Very, very difficult. When everyone else is enjoying their life, right, you are working hard. When everyone else says that, well, we are going for a movie, you are writing and typing your notes. When everyone else says that we are going for a movie, you are working on your books. Right? When someone else is enjoying their life fully, the person is saying that, well, I have a mission and a vision of life. And then you have a conviction. Someone says that, well, I think that you are made for it. And the person smiles and is so smart and says, yes, I'm made for it. Right? Otherwise, many times, a person also says, well, everyone is doing, let me also go on that line. 1%, not more than 1%, are those who set their own benchmarks, right, and who always strive for excellence, whatever they are doing. Right? For example, if they're working as a receptionist, there has to be a charm in the voice of a person who is a receptionist. And she says, hi, how are you? What can I do for you? I was charming it. And there is another person, he says, hello, Dr. Gurinder Singh. Nahi ji, wo kahan rehte hain ji? Achha, main dekhta hun. Right? And then nothing comes up. Right? So there has to be a charm. Whatever you are doing with excellence. Right? A small man, sometimes a young girl, a very young girl, a very young boy, 27, 28, do extraordinary work. Why they do it? Why they do it? Soldier who is fighting on the border, do you think that he works for money only? Right? But whatever he is doing, he is deriving and he is asking for excellence. The cameraman who is shooting, if he has a passion, he will shoot you from every angle. Right? The man who is singing, right? He is lost somewhere. He's singing. He's not singing for someone else, but he's singing for a passion. The one who's a boxer, right? He's boxing and he's concentrating that how he has to attack a person. The one who's a writer, he's writing naturally, he's getting satisfaction out of it. Wow. Delight. Excellent. The mother who's with a daughter or who's with a son, she's lost somewhere. What she will get at the end of the day? Right? All of you will fly. Right? When you're 17, 18, you will fly. Foreign countries, other countries. What parents will get out at the end of the day? But we never ask this question. We never ask this question because it's our passion to see. Good teacher, he will always want his students to do extraordinary things whenever he will see. Right? Today Nishant came and old memories came. Right? So the moment you see a person, you will say that, well, we always want you to become successful. You don't do it. You just don't do it for anything else. Whatever you are doing for excellence. That this is it. If you're playing a cricket, then you are concentrating on the ball. You will not see that who is bowling. And if you are you have a fear that someone who has played Ranji Trophy or the Delhi player is bowling against you, you will definitely be out. But if you are attacking on the field, surely you will score. So whatever you do, whether you are a receptionist or you are a CEO, if there is an excitement in that, you will surely become successful. in the last lesson which he gave was that never let success go to your head. Never let success go to your head. There is a Harvard case study which talks about it, about the product life cycle. And I think a few days back, I was in a class, and someone asked me, that is it a time to celebrate when you're getting success? No. It's a time to worry, right, when you are successful. Because it's important that you retain that position for quite long. A man who remains at the top for quite long, who has got a wide experience to be always at the top, is the one who is consistently thinking that what else, what new. So when you become successful, when everyone is cracking and everyone is saying that you have become something in life, you need to do and you need to introspect that what else is needed at this point of time. And this case talks about the Caesar cigarette, that when you are getting a success, the ITC started thinking of the new products and how you need to come with 20 other products. Right? And they say, in this case, that there is no word called recession in the world, economic recession, or depression in your personal life. Depression is for those, right, who understand that doors are closed. Right? Whenever you have a problem in your life, whenever you have a problem in your life, remember that God is there. Be truthful to yourself and try to do 20 other things. In one you can fail. Right? You are sowing 19 others. Out of that 19, I'm sure that if you will give your heart, your soul, maybe that 15, you are very successful. So the one who believes in doing a work or passionately does it, he will keep on sowing new things, experimenting with the new things, and will take the things very high. Remember, if you really want that there has to be excellence, you need to increase your efficiency. You don't have to look only at what you're going to achieve. You also have to see that in life, you will get success, you will get failure. It's not always that you will always be successful. Like no one can always be successful, right? And I'm going to show you the clipping where a person was a failure and years later, and then he was also Olympic gold medalist. He did both. He was a gold medalist and then in one of the Olympics he also lost, right? But when he lost, right, he said that I actually enjoyed the most. Sometimes winning is not giving you that satisfaction, but losing a game is giving you a lot of satisfaction. The story is of a man who was tipped to be the Olympic champion. Every newspaper front page was showing that he is going to win the race. He started running. An accident happened. And in that accident, he lost. When he lost, someone from the crowd came up, running to him. And he said that, you don't have to run now. You have already met with an accident. You will die if you will run more. He said, no, I have to finish my race. And he finished it. He finished it. Right? And when he finished it, the entire stadium stood up and they clapped for him on the spirit of the sportsmanship which he showed. Years later, in the next Olympic, he won gold also. And then years later, when he was writing his autobiography, he said, I think winning was not important. I think losing gave me more satisfaction. Remember, in your life, you need to look at that journey of excellence is more important than reaching at excellence. If you believe in the journey of excellence and you are trying to do excellent things while living your life, chances are that you will always be successful, you will always be happy, you will be rejuvenated, and you will be able to achieve what others have not achieved. Enjoy this clipping. It was a pleasure speaking to you today. Thank you very much.